Friends, when I read this act, for a moment I felt whether such an act is necessary. We have already had the Maharashtra Ownership Flats Act, and it has been there for the last nearly 50 years or more. And could we not have been improved upon that law itself? Or is it necessary that we should have this detailed law, whatever it is? And that reminded me of what we call the Parkinson's law. That is to say, okay, what we do, time expands, work also expands. We have one secretary, chief secretary, then we feel, no, we want to have one more. So what do we do? One chief secretary, then we appoint two additional chief secretary. Then we feel after some time, this is how the administration works. And that's all that's happened in this case, in this law. I have once a matter before me at the moment. I was looking at this matter, this act, from that point of view. I have a case where a builder had taken development of an earlier society of middle-class people. The project was that the old structure it is, demolish that, build a new structure, and he would bring money, he would do everything. Now, an agreement was entered into in 2002. The building project was to be completed by 2004, and we are in 2012, still nothing has happened. Some small part of the thing has still happened. He was paying some rent to the people who had occupied earlier, and they were shifted to some accommodation on their own with the money he was giving. He was giving for some time, he has stopped that. He was to pay property tax to the corporation. Now he was paying for some time, he has stopped that. Now of course, property is with him, nothing is coming up. In a situation like this, what is the remedy for the members of the society? So they invoked arbitration. Of course, see, today even arbitration in this country doesn't go on fast, it takes its own time. Again, it takes, you know, though under the Arbitration Act, Evidence Act is not applicable, Civil Procedure Code is not applicable, but the way we have interpreted the law in the court, that it goes on. Evidence, procedure, all technical defenses and so on. Okay, this is how it goes on. Then the case doesn't end. After the arbitration makes the award, it goes to the High Court. From the High Court, one may take it to the Division Bench. From the Division Bench, one can take it to the Supreme Court. This is a kind of thing. I was looking at it from the point of view, whether is there any solution for a situation of this type under this Act, and I found none. There is a provision under this Act that the moment a builder or promoter or whatever you call him starts a project, he has to register with the regulatory authority. And then he'll get a password. Then of course you talk to the website and this and that, all information. But how does mere registration of your project with the regulatory authority help a customer? I don't understand. He doesn't guarantee title. He doesn't guarantee that the work will be done at a particular time. He will do nothing of the kind. He can't guarantee. Because he has to only give a password at that time. On a password, the project is passed. In other words, whatever the difference, I can tell you from my experience, most of the agreements of the Ownership Flats Act required a certificate from the attorney to say the certificate is clear and marketable. And if you see, a layman sees, of course he doesn't understand, agreement is there, draft agreement, a certificate title is annexed, some solicitor has signed it, the layman can't understand, he reads that, he doesn't understand, what does it say, he thinks it's a clear title. But if you see carefully, in the, at least I can say, most of the cases, maybe some except here or there, the builder has a power of attorney, he has no title as such. Very often the owner is dead, till the builder acts in the power of attorney. That is the meaning. Actually, he has no power of attorney at all. His power of attorney is gone. There are disputes among the heirs of the owners. It doesn't reflect anywhere here. Okay? And then the lawyer who certifies, how does he certify? He says, he sets out, there is a power of attorney, there is a dispute among the heirs, there is a dispute about the title, there is a number of litigation, everything is pending. However, subject to the above, I certify. What's the meaning of that? Subject to the above, I certify. I think that's no guarantee. And many people have suffered on account of this. They think title is clear, you buy ownership block. It depends upon the builder who's fairly good, okay, he could do it. There are builders and builders. And what's the remedy? Remedy is go to the court. And therefore, I was wondering, what's the idea of registering with the regulatory authority, unless the regulatory authority has been given powers to certify the title and certify that the building can go ahead. Would he do that? In other words, what I'm trying to tell you is, under the law, you see the whole of this act, there is no provision for preventing a likely mischief that may take place when the project is going on. So what is important for a customer is a provision to see that this mischief is not done. How to do that? So if you want to go to a regulatory authority for the purpose of registration, then he should have a right to scrutinize your papers. He should have a right to see whether the certificate is clear or not. He should see whether the man has enough money in the bank or otherwise available for the purpose of going ahead with the project. He should see whether other likely obstacles. He should see whether the plan has been properly passed or not. All these things the regular authority does and then gives a certificate. I know I'm a customer, I have to just see the certificate. I'm sure nothing of this kind, there's no problem, I'm getting my flat. Unfortunately, the regular authority, there's no provision for regular authority doing any of these things. He gives a passport, I can say, to go ahead with the project, whatever the project. And this is one of the things which has to be considered seriously. Then, of course, after the building halfway constructed or during the construction, problem arises. Again, what the provision? Go to the regulatory authority. Okay, he may perhaps here, I don't know what he will do. He may give some relief here or there. I don't know what kind of relief he can give. Because if you see the provision carefully, he has to, of course, deal with that. Subject to the time factor, one doesn't know how much time it will take. And then again, okay, it is not there, it is not going to be over there. Then, of course, we have got an appellate authority. And what the appellate authority do, again, we don't know. And then, of course, the law says the appellate authority's verdict is not final. It is as good as a decree of the civil court, subject to an appeal. Now, appeal to the high court. I felt a little surprised. Of course, in the city of Bombay, we are all going to near to the high court, we go to the high court. This act applies the whole of Maharashtra. And something happened to Kolhapur, and he has to come to the high court on an item which is given initially by the regulatory authority, and then I don't know where the regulatory authority sits in Bombay, or there could be another regulatory authority in Kolhapur, but doesn't know. Whole thing is so vague, it's not clear, we are not sure, and we are not getting anything beyond what it was. And that is my reaction when I read this act. And of course, actually, there are a number of things which can be done. The whole thing is it is all based more or less on the basis of how the development has taken place all these years, because it is never regulated. Initially, of course, I compliment Mr. Bhatia, who started the idea of ownership flats. That's a wonderful idea, because at that time the houses were required for the middle class and the lower middle class. The rich had their own bungalows, they had their own apartments, had their own buildings, everything. They did not require any law. But the middle class and the lower middle class wanted a law. And ownership was not possible. And that is how we had the Bombay Rent Act. Bombay Rent Act was brought to solve this particular problem. And I think that was the best thing that we had. And like the Bombay Rent Act was the best in the whole of this country as it existed at that time. It guaranteed the right to the occupant, the tenant. It also guaranteed, to a certain extent, the right to the owner to get a reasonable return, not to exploit the tenants, and at the same time, that whenever he wants for his personal use, he would get it back, that kind of thing. Then, of course, things changed, and people thought, now we should have ownership flats. Initially, of course, ownership flats were fairly regulated in the sense, okay, there was a procedure, and we thought that could work out. There were very few cases of fraud, everything. But anyone can become a builder overnight. Anyone can bring money and invest and see what he can do. It will become a business. If you are straight in the business, okay, everything is straight. You are crooked in business, this is what happens. And that is how the whole situation has arisen. The government has no solution. People go to the court. In fact, I tell you, formerly the remedy was supposed to go to civil court. And I tell you, I can tell you one of the things. Whenever you go to the court, what do? You file a suit for specific performance. Then there comes the court fees. You have not paid the court fees. The document not registered, not properly stamped. All the technical questions. So once it came before me, and these questions were raised, I said, this is he not enforcing his right under the agreement. He is enforcing his right under the statute. So to enforce his statutory right, you don't have to pay any huge court fees. You pay rupees 30, because that's one of the provisions at that time. Pay 30, or now it is 300. And you can enforce a statutory right. And that judgment prevailed. All these years, quite a large number of litigation, when I met them, some of them when I met, they said, okay, we could now file a suit on the 300 rupees. Otherwise, pay court fees. Go to this court, question jurisdiction, all sorts of things were there. So ultimately, and then of course, I must say to the ingenuity of the consumer activists, the matter could come to the consumer court. Initially, people thought you can't take it to consumer court. But again, of course, slowly, slowly it has gained, and quite a number of people go to consumer court where, okay, not bad, the relief is somewhat, but again, limited relief they could give. For example, one of the things which came to me recently, a builder agreed to build give a flat. Measurements were there, and actually there was a time schedule. And then there was a problem if, for any reason, for some reason, the project is not completed, he would give a post-dated check of an X amount. And then, of course, the matter gets settled. Now, the question is, when you enter an agreement to buy a flat, you are not interested in getting money, you are interested in getting a flat for you. So at a time, some 5 years, 10 years earlier, you have an agreement, if I can't complete the project, I'll give an X amount. Of course, perhaps the idea was, see, the project is done. X was only a sort of penalty. It can't be that it will be treated as a compensation. So this is one of the questions that came, and I advised that party. I said, go to the consumer court. Over and above what you are getting under this, you are entitled to a further damage. Because that's the only way you can be properly compensated. Your idea was to get a house, not to buy a litigation, but ultimately you are forced to litigation. This is the kind of thing. So is there any solution on any of these things? My answer is no, there's nothing. Of course, I don't know. The government wants to bring this kind of law. Of course, some kind of regulation is required. But more importantly, the draft should have concentrated on preventive measures. They should have prevented, right from, you can't have a project, don't have a project. You can't get a clear title, don't have it. Because ultimately you are dealing with the customers who are innocent, who want an accommodation, or in need of accommodation, and then of course, likely to lead to litigation and so many other problems. That should not be there. I think this is a broad thing that came to mind. And it was Mr. Prabhu who invited me to say a few words. And when I went through, my reaction was, okay, one more law. You see, we say, we cannot commit ourselves, we committee yourselves. So things like that only, okay, there is a law which is there. Some remedy could have been thought of, some changes could be done. So, okay, suddenly we think of a new thing. And then again make it, again whole thing start, again where? It doesn't come to an end. Regulator authority decides, he takes his own time. 60 days, he files an appeal. Appellate authority takes his own time. Of course, again, job factor. Who will be the regulator authority? Retired secretary, principal secretary, or somebody, okay. Who will be appellate tribunal? Always a retired judge. You see, we have tribunals and tribunals in this country, and giving jobs for retired judges, and quite a number of judges are quite happy, because they get another 3 years or 5 years as a member of the tribunal, with all salary, perks, status, and everything. And not that they have an expertise. I remember in Pune, we had a professor by name Dr. Sate. And he's a great jurist and a professor of law. And he had written a book on tribunals. You see, we have recently series of tribunals of different things. So he analyzed 73 tribunals and came to the conclusion the tribunals have not done their job properly. We have a feeling, moment you have a tribunal, expertise will come. And he has analyzed and said, it has failed, it has not come. Because either the constitution of our tribunals are not proper, experts are not there in the tribunal, people who know nothing are members of the tribunal, this is how it happens. And he has analyzed clearly and said, the experiment of tribunals, I think, has not succeeded. And I don't know whether this will help anyone as such. Okay, thank you.